All the World by Charles M. Sheldon. Dedication, To Ambulance Company. This story, which was first read to my own Sunday evening congregation, and afterwards published in the Christian Herald as a serial, is dedicated to the Ambulance Company No. 347, which was composed almost entirely of students in Washburn College, Topeka, Kansas. They were all volunteers, and were listed with the 87th Division in the Medical Corps. This ambulance company made a unique record in the training camp before going overseas, passing the entire time in training without a single case of discipline or venereal disease. In dedicating this simple tale to this company, it is the hope of the author, who is the pastor of many of the members, that the same enthusiasm and patriotism that sent them as volunteers into the army will send many of them into the service of reconstruction of all the world. They are the very material needed during the period of upbuilding to do the work of making a new and better world. Some of them are already student volunteers, pledged to go into all the world and make disciples. They have kept themselves as pure and fit as Sir Galahad for the great quest. The adventures of peace will be more fascinating and alluring than the adventures of war. This book is a challenge to them and to all the youth in America to volunteer in the greatest service to the world that has ever been offered to the soldiers of the cross. End of dedication. Chapter 1. Amos Thatcher, the old photographer of Bradford, was honestly perplexed on that memorable day when the town decked itself out with all the flags and buntings and welcome banners it could buy, borrow, or secure, when the boys came home and the whole town turned out to greet them. There are certain events in the history of towns, as in that of individuals, which are epochal and deserve to be so treated. Such an event had come to Bradford. When the Ambulance Company 241 had been entrained for its camp, there had been no banners, no bunting, no brass band, no decorated streets and office buildings. The boys had gone away in a rather quiet fashion. Fathers and mothers, sisters and sweethearts, had come down to the train, and there had been abundant leave-taking after a fashion, but nothing exuberant or demonstrative. When the train finally pulled out, there was a cheer, and some waving handkerchiefs and hats, and hands reached up to the windows out of which the boys were leaning, and bundles and baskets of fruit and candy and lunches were caught at by smiling-faced lads, and the crowd had lingered round the station until the train was out of sight. And then it had scattered, very quietly and soberly, and eyes that had bravely and steadily looked into other eyes undimmed, now filled, and the step faltered in anticipatory thought of the unknown future for Ambulance Company No. 241. But the homecoming, ah, that was a different story. Bradford put on all its holiday and convention clothes. It spread its colors lavishly to the breeze. There was not a store, an office, a house, or even a barn without its token of welcome. Main Street was a fluttering rainbow. The little depot, which had not been painted for a good many months, was almost covered up with the colors of the sky, the sunrise, and the starlight. And the tragedy of it all to Amos Thatcher was the plain fact that he could not be everywhere at once to get all the views he wanted. There was the main street, and the post office, and the courthouse, and Dr. Grant's home. Grant was the company captain, and he was coming back with decorations pinned on him by Clemenceau himself. And there was the depot, and the incoming train, and the churches, and the G.A.R., and the mayor, and city officials, and the fire department, and the procession which had formed, and was even now extended all the way from the depot to the post office. To be sure, there were two other photographers in Bradford, but they were women, and Amos secretly sniffed at them and their outfit as altogether impossible and inadequate for the great occasion. He had flitted nervously all over town that morning, getting snapshots of nearly everything, but had finally come down to the depot to catch the boys at the exciting moment of their arrival. He planted his camera up against the end of the depot, put his black box with its plates down by it, and turning around as he rose, he knocked the hat off a man in the crowd. "Why don't you?" Amos started to complain irritably, and then, almost with comical rapidity, his own hat came off, and he dived down after the other man's. "Dr. Ward, I beg your pardon. All my fault. Here." He picked up the hat and handed it to the man, who took it with a smile that seemed to irradiate the atmosphere in a circle like a personal halo. "It's all right. All right, Thatcher. I got in your way." Amos Thatcher looked at Dr. Ward wistfully. "That's fiction, Doctor, but we understand you. Tell you what, while we're waiting, give me a group. You and Mrs. Ward and Esther. Where's Mary?"
"Down at the end of the platform," said the doctor. "But I..."
"Don't refuse me, doctor. Think of it. Here I have loaded down with hydroquinone and sulfite of soda and carbonate and bromide of potassium and pyro at $6 a pound and hypo and alum and acetic acid at $1.25 a gallon and maytol at $100 a pound. Just think of that, doctor, and it used to be $5. And just think of all the pictures going to waste here today. And Amos groaned as his eye took in the wealth of impossible chances on this day of Bradford's great celebration. "You don't mind just this once, do you, doctor?" Amos pleaded. "You have never given me a good chance at you, and here is Richard coming home with the Croix de Guerre and all that, and I want Mary in it, too." Dr. Ward smiled again, and returned Amos's pleading look with one that meant yielding affirmation.
"Mary is at the other end of the platform with the rest of the high school, but, oh well, come, Sarah Esther, it's only one day out of a lifetime. Give Amos his chance."
"Out here!" cried Amos, eagerly pushing through the crowd to a sunny spot outside the circle around the depot. And the crowd turned with real interest and amusement at the sight of Dr. Ward, his wife, and their oldest daughter forming a picture for Thatcher. For in all the history of Bradford, so far, no one had ever known Dr. Ward to have his picture taken, far less to stand for a group with his wife and daughter. So the crowd was at a high tension of excitement as it viewed the unusual sight with almost as much interest as Amos himself, who, when he had succeeded in posing the doctor and Mrs. Ward and Esther as they wanted them, turned about to find every person at that end of the little depot standing in a half circle, as if there were a real audience to a real show. Amos grinned at the sight, but turned his back on the crowd to give the doctor a direction. "I can't get a good picture with your hat on, doctor. You will take it off, won't you? Just a little farther in, Miss Esther. There, that's better. Miss Ward, if you please, a trifle back, just a trifle. Thank you." Amos held up his hand, adjusted the cloth, put his head under it, and at that precise moment an engine whistle blew. "They're coming, they're coming!" The whole crowd surged down to the track. Dr. Ward, dragged by Esther and Mrs. Ward, followed, and Amos emerged from the black cloth to find his picture slipping into the shouting, hurrahing mass of Bradford's best citizens in that moment of real life. Amos threw up his hands. Then he grabbed all the implements of his profession he could hold, and followed the crowd to get whatever he could, as he groaned over the marvelous pictures and groups going to waste on every side. And truly no picture or series of pictures could do justice to the homecoming of the Ambulance Company 241. The people ran out in front of the engine and surrounded the trains on all sides. Old Jim Wilson, the engineer, pulled up and stopped before he was within 100 feet of the depot platform, and climbed down out of his cab and joined the welcoming mob. There were so many scenes that an army of photographers, to say nothing of one Amos Thatcher, could not have got them. Men and women were crying and laughing and shouting and calling out the names of sons and brothers and husbands and lovers, crowding up on the steps of the coaches, trying to swarm into them, while the boys inside yelled to get out, and Jim Wilson stood helplessly by the side of his engine, wiping the tears off his cheeks with an oily rag, and swearing under his choking breath that he would be another day late getting into Bayview, next station to Bradford. But when the boys finally succeeded in getting out of the coaches and into the arms of their respective fathers, mothers, wives, sisters, and lovers, the company formed for its place in the procession, for Bradford was not going to be cheated of that procession, which it had projected in its imagination almost from the very day when Ambulance Company 241 had left for its training camp. The company would much rather have gone straight home without any fuss, but it good-naturedly understood the situation, and with more or less simulated protest consent to be lionized. They formed up in the place assigned by the marshal of the day, right behind the band, composed of high school students, boys and girls, proud of the honor and waltzing with excitement. The lines of citizens up the street through which the procession was to pass had fallen into the middle of the road in their eagerness to see the company, and were wondering at the delay, as all people at all processions always wonder. But the delay was inexcusable, for it was caused by the one company ambulance which number 241 had been permitted to bring home as a trophy. This ambulance had a history, and all Bradford had more or less knowledge of it. But the thing itself was what Bradford wanted to see almost as much as the boys themselves. Bradford was proud of its two cannon in the courthouse square at the base of the soldiers' monument, cannon of an obsolete pattern captioned by the boys of 61. But the younger generation knew nothing of their history, and only an occasional veteran would stop as he slowly crossed the square, and lay his trembling hand on the cold lip of the cannon's mouth, and linger a moment, memory travelling back over the 50 years. But the ambulance of Company 241 represented a new type of war, with new and strange weapons and appliances that even high school boys and girls understood, and when, after considerable delay, the shell-shattered car was brought out and cranked up, All Bradford, within seeing distance of it, set up a cheer that was heard beyond the post office and broke up the line of waiting delegations in the procession. The people who had been waiting impatiently there, mostly the older women and men who were not related to the company, broke from their places and surged down the street to the depot, and the marshal of the day, old Judge Grayson, in vain tried to reform the waiting lines. His horse, which was almost as old as himself, backed over the curb onto the sidewalk, and threatened to march hind first through Deacon Chandler's grocery store. The judge had not been on a horse for a good many years, and he soon found he had all he could do to reform himself, to say nothing of the impatient lines of citizens who swarmed down to see the ambulance and followed its course up the main street in a tumultuous, hurrahing, and altogether undignified manner, old men and women walking and dancing in front of the car like boys and girls at a circus parade. There was enough of the famous ambulance to go on its own power, and Richard Ward, Dr. Ward's younger son, was at the steering wheel, which was minus the upper half of its circle. The whole car was battered up enough to satisfy the pride of every Bradford citizen. "It sure has been to the war, all right," one after another said, eyes glancing now at the boys, now at the dumb but not silent witness of the company's share in the greatest war of the world. The sight of that ambulance, after a while, acted on the crowd in a curious way. As the procession slowly climbed the grade of Main Street, the shouting and excitement and noise grew less and less. The car wheezed and rumbled. A great ragged rent right through the main body of the old covered sides revealed where a piece of shell had torn. It was a rent which the boys had tried to mend by tacking over it a piece of folded canvas cut out in the shape of the Red Cross. The top of the radiator had been shot away, and only one wheel had all its spokes left. The frame had been bent and twisted out of plumb, and the whole thing wobbled over the street in a drunken fashion that required a skill born of acquaintance with its antics to steer, so as to prevent it skidding into the populace on one hand and backing down the street on the other. But as it rumbled along on that day memorable in Bradford annals, it seemed to be a thing of majestic and heroic build, its faded, rusted, misshapen form telling of the grim struggle over there. The mud of France was still clinging to its tires, and what was once the lifeblood of human beings stained the seats and the floor and even the sides of the wall within. No wonder that Bradford, by the time the company had come as far as the courthouse square, was quieter, almost as if it had begun to catch the real meaning of the story which the old ambulance had not only seen but made. For this is the story of the ambulance of Company 241, as told by Archie Nelson that night, to a crowd in the National Hotel lobby, after the reception was over and most of the boys had gone home to their own folks. Nelson was a lone sheep, and had no relatives in Bradford, and was staying at the hotel that night. At the request of the crowd, most of whom had heard the story before, but not at first hand, Archie gave the details, the crowd standing and sitting around in a rapt silence that embarrassed Archie, as he said he was not used to saying anything unless he had to yell louder than a 6-inch bomb. "You see, we were at Bellow Wood, over the ridge west of the Borcheres, Dick and Bert Chandler and two or three others." "You were there, weren't you?" a voice interrupted, the only interruption Archie noticed. "Well, of course, I'm telling the thing as an eyewitness would tell it," Archie acknowledged as he continued. "And it was pouring rain to beat Flanders, and that is pouring some. My hair is wet yet from Flanders. Well, we had driven the old car down the ridge, where we picked up three fellows, and were giving them first aid, when a bunch of botches jumped out of a clump of trees and began throwing hand grenades. We picked up the men we'd been working over, loaded them into the car, and Dick started her up the ridge, chug, 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 through the mud and over the holes, while Bert and I leaned up against the back end of the establishment so the fellows inside wouldn't slide out, and to give the old engine a heart, for she was beginning to have palpitation and compound fractures. Well, we were within 20 feet of the top of the ridge when a machine gun on the woods let loose on our right, and the first volley took the half of Dick's steering wheel right off, and also the best part of his right hand. He went on steering with his left and all that was left of the wheel, when a grenade took the top of the hood off and clipped several spokes out of the front tire. And at that moment the old engine went dead on us, just as a company of negroes broke over the edge of the ridge, flinging grenades at the botches and singing, 'It's a long, long way to any breakfast.' They quit singing long enough to yell a cheer for the Red Cross, and then swarmed down the ridge into the clump where the machine gun was fitting. Bert and I leaned as hard as we could against the old car, but we couldn't budge her. Then what happened but one of the fellows we had picked up and shoved into the machine seemed to come to life. At any rate, he backed off the floor where he'd been lying, and as his feet hit the mud, he said, 'Excuse me, fellows, for butting in, as I don't belong to this company and was never introduced, but if there's nothing the matter with my legs if my eyes is gone, and it strikes me your old buggy lacks pep.' He leaned up against the old thing alongside Bert and me, his face streaming with blood and rain, and if you'll believe me, the old thing began to move.
Not very far, for nothing less than a steam jack could have shoved her uphill through that mud. But just as she began to sag down again, what does that engine do but begin to thump again, chug, 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 with Dick sitting there minus one hand, working the mixer with the other, and steering with his teeth or something. The fellow who had slid out to push fell down when the engine started with a jolt, and Bert stepped on him accidentally, pushing him deeper into the mud. We had leaned over to pick him up and put him back into the jinrikisha, and had just got his head up to the one end of the cot, for one of the other fellows had slid off that onto the floor, when bang comes a shell and slams right through the barouche, carrying away the cot and killing one of the boys inside. But the engine kept it going and just wheezed over the ridge as a covey of shrapnel pattered around us and got Bert in the shoulder and me in the leg. As we began to slide downhill, we could hear the negroes yelling and singing, "It's a long, long way to any breakfast," as they charged over the machine gun and captured the whole bunch of Boche grenade slingers. After we got out of the hospital, Dick got the Croix de Guerre, and who should get the same at the close of the next day but Private Henry Munson of the 369th Infantry, formerly of the old New York 15th, a negro regiment. Munson was the first negro to get the Croix de Guerre, but a lot of them got it later. His company stood grinning in the pouring rain, it was still raining, while Munson received his honor, and when they broke rank, they were singing, "It's a long, long way to any breakfast, but we's gwine to get some now." And you can be sure they did get some, the first bite, though, they had had for 14 hours. Oh, yes, and I forgot to say that the fellow who lost his eyes but not his legs, and who helped push the buggy up that ridge, was a Marine by the name of Sam Rogers. He had gone over the slope with a handful of Marines just a few minutes before the 369th Infantry. Bert and I helped get him into the first base hospital, and as we laid him down, he came to and began to sing a line of the Marine Band chorus. If the Army and the Navy ever gaze on heaven's scenes, they will find the gates are guarded by United States Marines. We heard of Rogers before we left France. He's totally blind, but he's an expert stenographer and typewriter, with as good a position in Kansas City, and he's one of the most jolly fellows you ever saw. He says he owes his life to Ambulance Company 241, and I guess he does, but maybe we owe ours the extra push he gave us over the ridge at Chateau Thierry. The next few days at Bradford were days of excitement and much visiting and talking. The boys declared they were more exhausted at the close of each day than they had ever been on the hardest field of battle. But the homecoming was so great an event that they reveled in the lionizing, and Bradford gave several days to it. The ambulance, with due ceremonies, was installed as a permanent trophy on one end of the platform of the City Hall, with a neatly worded account of its adventures under a glass cover hung on one side, and the list of its heroes on the other. It was difficult for Bradford, in making out this list, to make any special note of individual heroes, and no attempt to do so seemed practical. As time went on, however, after the excitement of the first days from the welcome had subsided a little, a few persons emerged from the group and grew more distinct and outstanding than the rest. Among these was Richard Ward, Dr. Ward's son, the driver who had lost his right hand at the ridge of Chateau Thierry. Dick, as Nelson called him, and as he was known to every man in Ambulance Company 241, was an average American boy, one of thousands whom the Great War had developed into a grown-up, if not serious-minded, man. The first day that Dr. Ward had an opportunity to study his son's face, he was reminded of one of John Oxenham's poems, in which a father is pictured as asking his son what he has seen out there. Dr. Ward silently sat facing Dick, but inwardly he was going over Oxenham's verses, face to face with reality. "What did you see out there, my lad, that has set that look in your eyes? You went out a boy, you have come back a man, with strange new depths underneath your tan. What was it you saw out there, my lad, that has set such deeps in your eyes? Strange things, and sad and wonderful, things that I can scarce tell. I have been in the sweep of the wreath or scythe, with God and Christ in hell. I have seen Christ doing Christly deeds, I have seen the devil at play. I have gripped the sod in the hand of God, I have seen the godless pray. I have seen the devil in petticoats, wiling the souls of men. I have seen great sinners do great deeds, and turn to their sins again. I have sped through the hells of fiery hail, with fell red fury shod. I have heard the whisper of a voice, I have looked in the face of God. You've a right to your deep high look, my lad, you've met God in the ways, and no man looks into his face, but he feels it all his days. You've a right to your deep high look, my lad, and we thank him for his grace." They were sitting in Dr. Ward's little study off the library room, and talking about Dick's plans for the future. "I haven't any, Dad," Dick had answered, in response to his father's direct question. "What plan have you? You see, Dad, none of us has had much time to plan for careers. We have had so many careers in the old ambulance that we don't seem to care for anything common." "How about the university? You haven't given up the thought of college?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.